Qualifying is over for the Canadian Grand Prix and Max Verstappen has taken pole position in one of the most crazy and chaotic qualifying sessions of the year. Despite the conditions throwing up all kinds of variables, Max once again rises to it to take pole position. But whilst this sounds a little boring and predictable, the qualifying session was anything but boring and predictable, as we even had a Williams on top at one point during one of the sessions, and a Haas almost recreated Brazil 2022. And we're going to be talking about all of that as I do a data analysis from a hectic qualifying session. Now, let's get to the video. As usual, I'll be talking about the likes of Ferrari, Mercedes, Aston Martin and Red Bull later on, so stick around for that. A wet qualifying session always throws up a number of variables, especially when the qualifying goes from damp to dry and then back to heavy rain, and this was the kind of day where the drivers had to be on the right tyres at the right time. And one team that nailed this was the Williams team with Alex Albon in Q2. Albon took a huge risk at the start of Q2 by starting the session on the soft, dry compound of tyres. This was a gamble, but a lot of other drivers also wanted to go onto slicks as soon as the session started. However, Albon did it first and therefore was the driver that was able to build up the most amount of tyre temperature and therefore generate the most amount of grip, and was able to go fastest, and to show this, I have all of the lap times from Albon, Alonso and Max Verstappen. And what can we see? Well, what we could see is that Albon actually started off pretty slowly, but as the laps went on, he was able to just go faster and faster. Alonso opted to stick for the intermediate tyres in Q2, and he was still finding time, but when he changed onto slicks, you could see that he all of a sudden went a lot slower. The reason being that he did not have time to build up temperature and grip, unlike Albon. Albon can be very happy and proud of this result, as the Williams team can be as well, and even though he's in Q3, he didn't get to set a representative time during that final session due to his lap times being deleted. He's still starting the Grand Prix though from 9th place, and with the Williams typically being a faster car in a straight line, and the race likely being dry, there is an opportunity for Williams to bag some very valuable points. Another team which had a brilliant day in qualifying was the Haas team, specifically for Nico Hulkenberg. The Hulk put on a brilliant performance in the rain-soaked session of Q3, and found himself on the front row of the grid, until sadly a penalty knocked him back a bit. He managed this by being the only driver to get 2 timed laps on the board in Q3 before Piastri crashed. But where was he faster? Well, to take a look, I have the lap times of Lewis Hamilton in the Mercedes and Nico Hulkenberg from Q3 to just see where Hulkenberg was able to go faster with the extra lap. As you can see from this data, Hulkenberg makes up all of his time on the exits of all of the corners as he finds himself getting great grip on the exits of corners versus what Hamilton can achieve, and this is simply down to doing an extra lap, building more tyre temperature and therefore grip and also confidence. Despite the fact that the circuit is actually getting worse as the rain is getting heavier, the track is getting wetter and more treacherous, Hulkenberg is still able to find more grip. If others had the opportunity to get a second lap on the board, I don't think Hulkenberg would have been the second fastest, but even so, it was a brilliant result and goes to show how this qualifying was all about doing the laps and building confidence. In the race itself, I do think it will be difficult for Haas to sadly score any points, despite starting from P5. The reason for this is because I do think it will be a two-stop race, and the rear tyres are going to get worked very hard. Whenever it is a multi-stop race and tyres get worked hard, Haas struggle a lot more than their rivals due to their car being naturally very hard on its tyres. I have a feeling we may see something similar, and Hulkenberg could sink like a stone as the stints wear on, especially as they are very limited on data on those dry compound tyres. One other team that can be relatively happy, despite the way it ended, was McLaren. For McLaren, it was another strong qualifying in tricky and changeable conditions. We saw them also benefit, similarly to what Williams was able to do, by switching onto the dry compound tyres early in Q2, and you can see how it benefited them when looking at the lap times of Norris to Ocon. Norris swapped to the slick tyres a little bit earlier than Ocon, and therefore was able to build the temperature when the track was at its best. So let's look at their fastest laps and see what we can see. When you look at their fastest lap times, you can see that much like with Hulkenberg versus Hamilton in Q3, Norris is able to make up the majority of his time by being faster on the exits of corners due to having slightly higher tyre temperatures and more confidence in the tricky conditions. McLaren may struggle in the race, but with the two drivers in the top 10, I do think it may be possible for at least one of them to score points for the first time since 2014 at Montreal. I do just want to say that if you are enjoying the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more F1 content. Now, let's get to the top 4 teams and let's start with Ferrari. For Ferrari, Montreal qualifying was a complete disaster. Sainz was consistently blocking other drivers, and in my opinion, he was very lucky to only be hit with a 3-place grid penalty. As for Leclerc, Charles wanted to go onto the soft tyres earlier in the session, but Ferrari opted to leave him out and then changed him onto slicks too late, which did not give him enough time to build temperature in the tyres to set faster laps. Charles was left in no man's land in a way, as he was too late for slicks, but didn't stay on the inters long enough to maximise those tyres like Alonso was able to do. To show this, I have the fastest laps of Albon to Leclerc to see what we can see. Leclerc is significantly slower than Albon just about everywhere on the circuit. Due to Leclerc being so slow through the exits of chicanes, he's not able to get up to the same top speeds as Albon. For Ferrari, this is a disastrous session, as they were looking like they were very much podium contenders. But for them now, it will all be about trying to fight back to P5 at best. For Aston Martin, qualifying in Montreal was a very mixed bag, as once again, one driver is starting the Grand Prix from the front row of the grid, and the other driver is right at the back of the grid. Can you guess which one it is? Yes, sadly, once again for Lance Stroll, it has been a disastrous day, and due to a grid penalty, he will be starting all the way down in P16 on the grid, and will have a lot of work to do if he is to score any points in the Aston Martin. Stroll had a similar issue to Leclerc in qualifying, where he switched from inters to slicks a little bit too late, and therefore was unable to maximise his potential on the dries, and also was unable to get the most out of the intermediate tyres. Stroll, though, did make a few errors on his qualifying laps, and when comparing the fastest lap of Lance Stroll to Fernando Alonso, it all becomes clear. Alonso is in white, and Stroll is in green, and what can we see? In the braking zone before the DRS activation zone 1, Stroll is significantly slower than Alonso, and cannot carry the same amount of speed, as Alonso is pretty much on full throttle, whereas Stroll is not anywhere near that. Also, through the hairpin section, Stroll is a lot slower than Alonso through that corner, and this goes to show once again the difference between Alonso and Stroll. For Mercedes, once again, they are the team that maximised qualifying and are in the best position to maximise their potential points for both drivers, as Hamilton and Russell are both starting on the second row of the grid. In the dry, I do think we could see, potentially, both Mercedes cars on the podium, as they were looking good in FP2 during the dry session. There's not too much to compare when looking at their lap times, due to their laps being all over the place, as you can see when looking at all of their lap times as a whole. And finally for Red Bull, it was another tale of two halves. Once again, Max Verstappen looked incredible out on track, and was in complete control of his car, whereas his teammate Sergio Perez is once again out in Q2. And despite the Red Bull being even more dominant than it was last year, it feels like Perez is actually performing worse than what he did last year. As you can see when looking at both drivers' lap times, Perez is never really faster than his teammate Verstappen. Also, when the drivers changed from inters to slicks, Perez was left in a similar condition to Leclerc and Stroll, and you can see that his fastest lap was set on the intermediate tyres, not the dry tyres. And when you look at the fastest laps of both Verstappen and Perez, you can just see the advantage Verstappen has when he has built confidence and grip on those soft tyres versus Perez, who was still on the inters. Verstappen is able to brake much later, and also he doesn't have to slow down as much as Perez, and therefore carries more speed through the corners. For Verstappen, this looks like another walk in the park. But for Perez, I do think he will struggle to finish in the top 5 in this Grand Prix. So with that in mind, what is my prediction for the top 5 in the Canadian Grand Prix? In P5 it will be Esteban Ocon, P4 will be George Russell, P3 will be Fernando Alonso, Lewis Hamilton will finish in 2nd place, and Max Verstappen will take another victory. But the question is though, what do you guys think? Let me know in the comments down below. And as always, comment, leave a like, and subscribe for more F1 content. Thank you all so much for watching.